Okay, let's stir us up a little bit and acknowledge ourselves for coming in tonight. Do you look as forward to getting together?
Yes.
As I do some of you anyway. Some of y'all feel that way. Yeah. Just remember, this is a way of mastery. And tonight we're going to be in the path of the way of transformation. And the way of transformation, if you got the book, the page I'm going to be on is page 194 in the way of transformation. And the section that we're going to cover tonight, as much as we can, is called Fear Has Taken Its Final Form. Mm-hmm. I asked Spirit for a section, and that's what I was given. Mm-hmm. It's called Fear Has Taken Its Last Form.
Yeah.
Fear has taken its last form. So we know in order to open our mind that we need to remind ourselves what? That we don't have to believe it. We don't have to accept it. We don't have to welcome it. Some of it might be startling and hard to believe, different from what we've learned, but if you use it, you'll see that it's true because it'll change your interpretation of what's going on. The Course in Miracles says that an open mind is a mind that believes that it doesn't know everything. Is there anybody in here that knows everything? So you can pull this off. Okay, so the paragraph, I'm going to go through the paragraph, then I'm going to go through the paragraph, and then we're going to open it up for questions for a minute, then I'm going to go through, you know, you got it, very specific. Okay. It says here, in this world, here, fear has condensed into its final form. Mm. So the Course in Miracles teaches that the reason why the ground beneath our feet seems solid is that what we're walking on is a concrete form of fear.
Wow.
Just like if you had to change water into ice. We've taken our fear and created physical. Mm. Now, remember that, you don't have to believe it. This is just another way of looking at it. It's very different, isn't it? But it's fear here. Okay, all right. He says, there can be no further condensation of the energy that has become fear. So this is as fearful as fear can get. For egoic consciousness is fearful consciousness. So the Course defines, the way of mastery defines an egoic consciousness as a consciousness that's afraid. So your fear and your ego are the same thing, according to the teachings of the way of mastery. They're the exact same thing. And the ego is fear. So when you say my ego made me do it, doesn't it look like then you're saying it's my fear that made me do it? Mm-hmm. So if I'm going through something, then it's lack or fear or sickness or attack or anything. He says it's our ego, which means it's my fear that's creating it. Yet even your fear is made of pure power, pure potentiality, and unlimited creativity, which means we have used our unlimited creativity to create a physical form of fear. We have unlimited creativity, but you may be directing your unlimited creativity toward fear. Rest assured, you all have the experience of knowing just how ceaselessly creative your ego mind can be. It's just no end to the ways we can screw ourselves if we really want to. I mean, we can just be so creative in that way. I thought I didn't have unlimited creativity. I do have unlimited creativity. I just can create unlimited levels of crap sometimes. Stuff, right? All right, now he says, for without ceasing, your ego, which is the part of you that's afraid, the way of mastery says, it knows how to immediately look upon another brother or sister. The fearful part of our mind knows how to immediately look upon an event. It knows how to look upon anything. And in that fast, in the twinkling of the eye, in a space that doesn't even require a thought, your egoic consciousness can change its values, can change its perceptions to create what it wants to create. So we can look at anybody, we can look at anything, and just like that, we can see it any kind of way we want to see it. I can go from feeling real good about you to being mad at you in 1 second. I can be a feel good sitting up here, and then I can tell you something that you don't like, and immediately your feelings can change. So we can change our values and our perceptions and see it the way we want to see it in a twinkling of an eye. So what it wants to create is that which continues its existence. So the fear in your mind wants to create the things that keep the fear going in your mind. The fear in your mind, that part of you that makes fear, he says, wants to create things for you that keep you afraid. So it's the part of me that wants to keep me afraid, which I call it the part of me that wants to keep me upset about something all the time. Mm-hmm. Have you noticed there's just no end to it? Mm-hmm. You know, you always say, as soon as I get this handled over here, I'm really going to be happy. And then as soon as you get that, then it's something else, and then it's something else, and then it's something else, and then it's something else. Mm-hmm. Well, that's because the fearful part of our mind, in order to continue itself, has to keep us in some form of fear and conflict to continue to fear. That makes sense. Mm-hmm. So much like in your physical body, when a cell becomes cancerous and decides to run amok, that's what a cancerous cell is, a cell that's run amok. So based on this, we know we must be some form of spiritual cancer. Because it looked like some people running amok everywhere around here. So you know what I'm saying? That's a part of me that runs amok. You know, somebody mess with me, I'd be saying, muck you. You know what I'm saying? So when a cell runs berserk and it runs amok, it says it acts as though it were not dependent on the laws of the body itself to keep the body healthy. Then that cell begins to do what? It begins to create cells like unto itself. I'm gonna slow that down because that's so deep. It's saying that if you are a cancerous cell that's run amok, what you're gonna do is you're gonna act as though you are not dependent on the laws of God, the laws of truth that keep you healthy. In other words, it's like when we run amok, what we're doing is we're making it up. We're making up our own rules and our own laws, and we're not learning what the laws of the universe are. We don't know what the universal laws are. We don't know what the laws of the Creator are. So everybody's making up their own laws, and they call it my truth. Mm-hmm. Everybody tells you they got their truth. Well, the trip about that is that nobody knows your truth but you. So if everybody's got their own truth, then how are we really going to join and communicate peacefully? It's almost impossible. So that means that all of us are acting out of accord with the universal laws that rule all of us. There are laws that rule all of us. I don't care what your race is, what your religion is, what your spiritual belief is, what your sex is, what your gender is. If all the air was cut off in this room, all of us would fall over on the floor. Mm-hmm. So what's real, what's a real law works, period, regardless of your beliefs about it. Mm-hmm. You follow what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But what we do is we make up our own laws, and then we wonder why the world is total chaos, because we've forgotten the universal law, which is basically you create your own reality by your way of seeing things and your beliefs. And all of us are ultimately acting according to the thoughts in our mind. So we're all living out our own thoughts. We have that in common. So it says that cancer is merely a misperception run amok at the level of the body that is thinking for itself, creating in its own image, rather than extending the image of the Creator and living out of harmony with the one mind that creates in radiant joy for no other reason than to extend the good, the holy, and the beautiful. Oh, everybody got that? I'll say that again. We're making up our own rules. We're making up our own beliefs. We're trying to do it our own way, rather than saying, I want to extend the image of my Creator, and I want to live out of harmony with the one mind that creates in radiant joy for no other reason than it wants to extend what's good and beautiful. I want to be a means for the Creator to extend through me in total harmony what creates radiant joy and total beauty for me in my life. That's what you do when you're not a cancerous mind. Mm-hmm. When you're not a cancerous mind, you want to act in alignment with the love that creates everything, and you want to be a conduit for that love and abundance to come through. When you're out of alignment, you're making it up as you go along, trying to control everybody around you based on the fantasies and dreams that you've decided that they should act out for you in order to meet your needs. Mm-hmm. So has anybody here ever went to bed with a cancerous mind? Sometimes it's terminal. Mm-hmm. Just read the newspaper. So a guy, just the other day, the guy just took his girlfriend out. Took her out, murdered her, just because he thought that she had a boyfriend on the side. She didn't even know.
Oh, my God.
So now, the thing that's such a trip about that is that's an example of what we're talking about, a mind that's run amok. That's a mind that's run amok, that's acting according to his own beliefs that have nothing to do with reality. So it says, God doesn't create limitation. God doesn't create limitation. God doesn't create limitation. Love doesn't create limitation. Love doesn't create limitation. God doesn't create limitation. The Creator doesn't create limitation. Wow. And therefore, the Creator does not withdraw creativity from the power of the ego. So we were just told the Creator does not limit anything, so it's not going to even limit your power to create fear for yourself if you want to. You're so free, you can create a messed up life yourself in your perception. You're so free, you can create as much fear as you want to create. The Creator does not limit in any way, including limiting what you want to keep going. That's called fear, is what we're being told right now. So one of the thoughts I want to reflect on for just a minute is that the Creator doesn't create limitation. The Creator doesn't create limitation. God doesn't create limitation. The Creator doesn't create limitation. Creator doesn't create limitation. So what we are supposed to be doing is extending the image of the Creator and living out of harmony with the one mind that creates in radiant joy. I live out of harmony with the one mind that creates in radiant joy. We want to live out of harmony with the one mind that creates radiant joy. And we want to create radiant joy for no other reason than to extend the good, extend the holy, extend the beautiful. That's what we're here to do, to extend the good, to extend the innocent, to extend the beautiful. God does not create limitation. The Creator doesn't create limitation. The Creator doesn't create limitation. God does not 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 create limitation. Love 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 does not create limitation. Limitation. Love does not create 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 limitation. Love doesn't limit you. Love doesn't limit you. God doesn't limit you. God doesn't limit you. Doesn't even limit your ability to create as much fear for yourself as you want to. It says, rather, because God is love, all power under heaven and earth is available and can be tapped into by your ego. Even your ego can tap into the power to create what it wants to create. Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. So, what is egoic consciousness? Now, let's see if we can really get clear about what is egoic consciousness. What is egoic consciousness? I'm going to repeat a lot. I specialize in repeating. I did it when I was in school. You know, Jesus had a disciple. What was his name? Repeater? What was his name? Repeater? What is it? So what is egoic consciousness? You all know what it feels like to be absolutely certain that you are separate, absolutely certain that you are alone. You know how it feels like to feel absolutely certain that you must rely on your own thinking processes. Mm-hmm. You know exactly what it feels like to feel that no one beyond, not just the boundary of your body or skin, but no one beyond your unique contracted sense of I has any connection to you whatsoever, and you know that there's a part of you that believes nobody really cares.
Yeah.
And if you lament sometimes, I am alone. I'm separate. How on earth am I going to make it? I got to figure my own way. I got to figure out how this whole world works. I've got to make it happen for myself. Anybody familiar with this?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Fear has taken its final form. When you get to the point that you're talking like that, the way of mastery says, that's how you know you are as afraid as you can be. And now there is a complete, at that point you think you're all alone and you're separate. Mm-hmm. He says, well, at that point, there's a complete forgetting of God. At that point, you've forgotten the one, that you've forgotten spirit, that you've even forgotten your own soul. And then it says, then your body, represents a level of vibration. Every one of these bodies are a level of vibration. Some levels of vibration are 36, and some are 24, and some are 36. Now, so we have numbers for the vibrations. I'm vibration number, well, we're not going to talk about what vibration number I am, but we call it age. That's a vibration. The body represents a level of vibration. But your body is still quite intelligent vibration, and it's still a very intelligent vibration. I said again, your body is a very intelligent vibration. Kind of gives a new meaning to you got good vibes. You know, I like your vibes. Your body is a matrix of energy. That's a vibration, that's a matrix of energy. Now, what does that have to do with me paying my rent? Mm-hmm. What does that have to do with me getting the career going that I'm trying to get going? Well, you must understand that your body is like a matrix of energy. So the very thought of condensation into human form, I love that. The body is a matrix of energy. It's the very thought of condensation into human form. So your body is a condensation of a matrix of energy into physical form that is sitting on a chair. And out of which forms keep getting created. This form creates a form called my son, who creates a form called my grandson. So my form keeps creating forms, that keeps creating form, that keeps creating form, that keeps creating form, that keeps creating form. And you have done that for yourself an infinite number of times. This is not your first matrix of energy that you have condensed into a physical form that you call a body that thinks it's separate and alone on its own and has forgotten how it was created. Your body is a representation of your ego. Your body is the physical result of thinking that you're separate. Because if you are going to be separate, you have to be separate in something. So if I'm going to be separate from you, I've got to be separate from you in something. There's got to be a boundary between me and you. There's got to be something that separates me from you. Because without a body, we wouldn't think we were separate. Without our bodies and without our egos, we wouldn't think we were separate. So the body is a condensation of fear to reflect the idea that you think you're separate. So the mind thinks it's separate, and then the mind creates a body to witness to the separation, to house the idea of being separate. And that's how we ended up in bodies. We're actually mind, spirit, that has imagined what it would be like to be separate. Because we can imagine anything. We're unlimited in our creativity. So at one point in creation, you went, I wonder what it would be like to think I'm separate from God. I wonder what it would be like to think I was separate from everybody. Boy, I wonder what it would be like to be different. From that, but the problem was, we forgot our connection to source. We forgot our connection to God, that which created us. And so when you forget your oneness, because that's what you have to do in order to be separate. You can't be separate without forgetting your oneness. Everybody can kind of reason with that, right?
Yeah.
If I'm going to think I'm not one, then I've got to forget I am. All right. So that's fearful, though, because then I think you all are strangers that I don't know what you all are going to do to me. So, and I'm in a body that seems very fragile and that anything can happen to me. Hoping that I'll be loved by somebody. That's fearful. So then I have my matrix of energy, take the vibrational level of being a body that thinks it's on its own and afraid trying to make it. So your body is a representation of your idea that you're afraid and that you are separate. And then you identify with your body and you think your body is you, and then you become defensive because it's all about protecting it, feeding it, taking care of it, housing it, and making sure nobody does anything wrong or bad to it. That's sort of different from the birds and the bees. That's a different idea of creation. That you are unlimited beings who decided to see what it would be like to think you were separate. You were born into a body to give you that experience, but in order to take it seriously, you had to forget who you really are and forget that you really are an unlimited spiritual being connected to source. And when you forget who you really are, you work at jobs you hate, you're in relationships that don't satisfy you, your financial situation isn't pleasing, you're bored, you're doing the same thing over and over again, and you're just living to try to make it. In other words, you become an ordinary average person.
Right.
Now, how we jam ourselves up is instead of getting back to the realization that we are the minds that created it, so therefore we could create it another way, we look outside of ourselves to solve the problem, and then we try to change everything on the outside without trying to change anything about what's happening on the inside.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't ever solve the problem. So, but notice that as you sit in your chair, you're quite certain that you're not the wall across from you. As I sit in this chair, I'm pretty certain that I'm not that wall across from me. As you sit where you are in your chair, your consciousness, your awareness tells you that you are the listener to this or the reader of this book, but you're certainly not the author of this book. So you think, no, not me. I couldn't do that if I wanted to. I couldn't do something like this if I wanted to. Certainly it makes Yeshua or Jesus very special, or any spiritual master very special, but I'm just this blob of dust. See, I'm not special. I'm just this blob of dust sitting in my chair, reading and listening to these words which vibrate with a certain meaning, these words which create certain pictures and understandings in my mind, and these words are being placed within me, and I am not the one that's putting all this in me. I am not the one that created this body. I'm not the one that created this experience. That's not me. That's just special masters that can do all that kind of stuff. Certainly, I'm not the one that's creating everything that I'm experiencing in my experience. It's your ego consciousness that says, I'm not that one. I'm not God. I am not a part of the Creator. I don't have this power. I'm not pure spirit. I'm not pure soul. I'm just this thing that's sitting in this friggin' chair, wondering when this class is gonna be over, hoping that I can even make it a whole nother hour. And do you know something? You're absolutely right. You are that. You are this thing that seems to be sitting in the chair, but you are a whole lot more than this thing that seems to be sitting in the chair. You're much more than this body that seems to be sitting in the chair. You're more than this body that seems to be sitting in this chair with all your problems that you think you're dealing with in the world that everybody else is dealing with. You are more than anything that you think you are.
Mm-hmm.
Any questions or comments about what I've said so far?
Whoa.
I started out light tonight.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's why I never have to worry about having to people outgrowing the room.
Oh, Earl.
You can be more honest and straight up and go deeper with small groups of people than you can with tons of people. Mm-hmm. I'm living proof of that. So if I ask everybody in here what's causing you to be sitting in a chair, you could just whip that out on me just like this. No problem. You got it down pat, right? Okay, why are we sitting in the chairs?
Because I choose to.
Because we choose to. Why do you have the body that you have?
Because I choose it.
Mm-hmm. And what was behind creating it?
Fear. The desire
for separation. And does the part of us that's afraid, would that part of us want to keep it going? Mm-hmm. Is that same thing true about the part of us that believes in lack or the part of us that believes in limitation? Mm-hmm. It wants to keep itself going. So if you're a person that's always dealing with a lot of drama, you're only experiencing your own ego trying to keep itself going. Mm-hmm. And that's what you call your bad day or your bored day. You're just trying to keep it going. That's deep, man. Mm-hmm. Okay, anybody else? In the comments, that's a big question. It's being all off. Okay, well, the egoic mind is that mind which creates the separate perception that it is one tiny slice of the pie. See, you think you're one tiny slice of the pie. So your ego creates a delusion. Your ego creates a distortion in your consciousness itself, like a little blip on the radar screen that tells the one watching the screen that there's something really there. In other words, your egoic mind says, I am separate, I am alone, I cannot think with the mind of God. I'm separate, I'm alone, and I can't think with the mind of God. I can't think with the mind that's completely powerful and completely loving and completely creative. I can't experience unity consciousness with you. I can't be as Yeshua was. No, not me. I'm too small. I'm too weak. Oh, I just don't have it together yet. But maybe someday. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Someday I'll have it though. It's gonna happen one day. But right now I just can't. I'm just too small. I'm just too weak. I know I want to have whatever it is I think I want to have, but for some reason I just can't have it. What is it? I'm too small. I'm too weak. I can't experience unity consciousness. I can't think with the mind of God. I can't have my whole experience change in an instant to something that's happier than I can ever imagine. I'm too small. I'm too weak. I'm too guilty. I'm too bad. I'm not enough. Yet all the while, you are that power. You are that power. So by the power of that one, you have the potential to think the thought, I could never be like Yeshua is. I'm really too small, too weak, too stupid, and too weak, fragile, small, and stupid. In other words, I can use all of my power to convince myself that I'm small, fragile, weak, and stupid. That's all. You have these unlimited spiritual beings walking the street convincing themselves that they're small, fragile, weak, and stupid, and lacking, and not enough. So you're watching people using their unlimited power to imprison themselves. But everybody's using their unlimited power. Everybody's using their unlimited power. But many people are using their unlimited power to limit themselves. And then they get other people to help them. And we call that, I'm in a relationship. When you really become afraid of your freedom, you get a relationship. Because then you can limit yourself and blame somebody else. But it's just them limiting you as much as you want to be limited. You got a jealous boyfriend that won't let you out of his sight because you want a jealous boyfriend who doesn't like you, let you out of his sight because you don't want to be free. You're scared of what you do without that limitation. You keep yourself broke and not having money because you're afraid of abundance. If you're bored, you're afraid of phone.
That's unfortunate.
Mm. So, I mean, that's really deep, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's really, really deep when you think of that. Any questions about that? Any thoughts about that? How do you think you're using your power right now? I'm afraid of mine. Because I'm having an experience where the blessings in my life are out of control. I used to successfully be able to stop the good stuff. I can't stop it now. It's overruling my negative thoughts. I finally have more loving thoughts than I have fearful thoughts. So my loving thoughts always overrule my fearful thoughts. So every time my fearful thoughts try to create something, my loving thoughts come right behind it and clean it up. I say just like a baby messing on itself, and then the baby getting cleaned. That's what I feel like. I'm like, this little infant body from God shitting myself, and then God, cleaning me off.
Okay.
But I'm an infant. You see what I'm saying? I'm an infant. There's this invisible parent that's taking care of me that I don't really quite understand. Could you imagine what you look like from the perspective of a baby?
Mm-hmm.
You know, just imagine that. The baby's laying there. He can't do nothing for himself, right? And then there's this giant shadow standing over them that reaches up and reaches down. You know what I'm saying? Think about that. But and the giant shadow is saying something to you that you don't really understand what it's saying. Goo goo da da goo goo da da goo goo or whatever you're saying. But to the baby don't understand English, right? So the baby is helpless. You're cleaning it up when it messes up. It's looking at this invisible giant thing over it, talking something that it doesn't even understand. But one day, the baby is going to realize that those strange figures are taking care of it and protecting it, and it's going to be speaking the language that the strange figures are speaking that right now it doesn't understand. That's us.
Yeah.
We are the baby. We are being told, you all are shitting yourselves. Get it out your mouth. Because baby don't know no better. They be playing with it, you know what I'm saying? Right? And all these books keep saying, you a friggin' baby. You are a baby when it comes to recognizing the truth, when it comes to recognizing love, when it comes to knowing what's really going on. You don't know. I will clean you. I will feed you. But you have to be willing at some level to have some little bit of willingness to let it happen. But I tell you that, the baby don't have no choice. I'm going to clean the baby whether the baby likes it or not. Because the baby smells. And that's where the angels are with us. Clean them off. Clean up that financial situation. Clean up that health situation. Clean up that shitty relationship. Clean up that shitty job they got. And we going, we fighting. I want to keep it. Oh, I love saying shit. I'm going to lose a whole Course in Miracles audience because I'm talking like this. Okay. Because we know holy people never say things like that. That's the definition. Holy is right there in the holy book. You don't say shit. If you're holy. And the truth is, when you really become holy, you don't say shit. You don't say nothing. You be quiet. That's how you know you're getting it. The person that's least aware is the one that's talking the most. That explains why I'm doing the class. I'm the most that needs what I'm teaching. And I'll talk to you all until I get it. So you better enjoy me while you can. Because when I get it, I'm going to stop talking. Because you're only talking to convince yourself anyway. That's why when a person is new to something, they're the main ones that's trying to get everybody else to believe it because they don't get. So they're trying to convince everybody around them. That's why I like new people, because sometimes new people, they get excited. They bring other people because they're trying to get it. So they get excited. They want to bring, you know, a lot of times when people have been in something for a long time, they don't bring nobody never. Because they are accepting it more and more for themselves. Mm-hmm. So it encompasses less and less of a need to involve anybody else. So it's perfect. I mean, I'm not coming down on y'all that haven't brought anybody since 1992. But it's just... the way I live proves God to me. Mm-hmm. Being a full-time teacher of material like this proves God to me, because there's no logical reason why I should be taken care of based on what I teach and what I do and what I'm teaching and how people come and go. My point in saying this is there are universal laws that will work for you regardless of what anybody else is doing in your life or anything that's happening in your life. Mm-hmm. We need to get in touch with those laws so that we'll never be in an experience of lack in any way. Mm-hmm. The reason why a person is suffering is because they are in their ego, which means they are making it up as they go along and making up their own truths and their own beliefs and trying to act out of their own truths and own beliefs, and then trying to get other people to conform to those beliefs, or attacking other people who have a different set of beliefs. That's how you know you're dealing with a fearful, egoic consciousness. They don't allow anybody to be. So the more fearful a person is, the more controlling they are. My life is easier than it's ever been because I'm not consciously trying to control anyone, but I'm totally willing to control someone who wants to be controlled. Mm-hmm. Because I'm only going to use one type of control. The kind of control that works all the time, which is, I free you. Mm-hmm. Because if you want to have something, you have to free it. If you really want to have something, you have to really free it. So, I want to be free, so I'm going to free all of you. Mm. Which really is funny, because I don't have any control over your freedom anyway. So it's just all for my own ego's sake. That I'm like, when somebody tell me, I'm going to free you. Well, thank you so much. Free me. I really, really appreciate it. But if I really want to limit them, then I will play the game of them limiting me. But it's got to be mutual limitation coming down. So if I want to limit you, then I'm going to let you limit me. That's why when you tell people they're free, they don't get that excited. Because that means that everybody's free, including the people that they want to control. Yeah. Isn't that funny? That I will not be happy about my own freedom if I think that it will keep me from limiting what you do and controlling what you do. So, the whole while, that very thought must use the power of that one. So even for you to give yourself any kind of fearful situation, you're still using the power of God. And that power is life. That power is pure being. That power is the real world. And that power is the only thing that exists, period. So what do I mean by the power of that one? You have dreamt the thought of having a separate self. You are dreaming up your own separate self by the power of that one, which we call God. When you decided to, and whenever you decide to, you can wake up from every thought of fear and ego consciousness that you have anytime you want to. You could stop being afraid of anything, worried about anything, unhappy about anything. We could all right now decide to wake up from any thinking that's based on fear and separation in our ego. We don't do it because there's a payoff in keeping that old way of thinking going. So now, why is all this important? Why is everything that I'm saying important? What does that have to do with our experience? He says, well, the way of transformation requires that there be that which exists in form. So if we're going to transform, we have to exist in a body. We have to exist in a form for the way of transformation to happen. We have to be where we are right now, because the transformation has to start with where you are right now. Your transformation has to start with where you are right now. If I think I'm a physical man named Earl Purdy, that's where my transformation must start, in this body, with this body right now. To you that's sitting in the chair, you know the space and volume of your human body. You know the particular thoughts that you identify as your own thoughts. You have a history to that body mind. You have a history to your body. There's a history to your mind that emerged from sexual desire. You are here because your form emerged from some form of sexual desire between two beings called parents who got together. You're here because of the sexual desire between two people who are your parents that came together for whatever reason, and a little thing wiggled its way up to touch another thing. A little thing wiggled its way up to touch another thing. A little thing wiggled its way up to touch another thing. Woo! And there was a burst of light. The little thing wiggled up to another thing. Then there was a burst of light. And then a pure spark, a pure soul, made a decision from intentionality to become fixated or identified with as a physical form. So when all that happened and the body was formed, you had the idea, I'm going to jump in here and have this experience. And poof, now you're in a physical body. Because the two people came together through sexual desire to produce the vehicle that you entered in order to have the physical experience of being a person that's separate. Mm. So sex created the vehicle for you as a consciousness to come into this experience and experience yourself as a physical body sitting in the chair being separate, worried about your bills. All the stuff we could do, think about how we're using ourselves.
No,
think about that just for a second. When you really think about what we were just told and think about how the average person doesn't wake up in the morning and look at their body with wonder, doesn't wake up in the morning and look at the sky with wonder, walks out here in a beautiful day like this and see trees and all the grass and all this beauty, and all this thinking about is, bam, you know, will I get a chance to make it to that movie? You think about what we preoccupy ourselves. We're right in the middle of miracles and completely preoccupied with fearful, stupid, boring stuff.
Right?
He says, so having a good time on Saturday night is the source of your being as a bodily being. If you were lucky, both of your parents, now this is what happens when you are, when two sane people give birth to a child. That'd be interesting to find out, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Let's see what two sane people do when they give birth to a child. Because I don't know about you, but my parents didn't know the way of mastery. Mm-mm. What about yours?
Mm-mm.
So pretty much we were not raised by enlightened beings. Is this correct? Okay, so can we forgive them? Okay, they didn't know any better. They didn't know any better. They learned some stuff from their parents. You know what I'm saying? But we are the ones that's supposed to, the muck is supposed to stop here. You know, there's the buck that stops here. But the muck, I mean, we are supposed to be the end of the insanity. It's supposed to stop with us. The fear is supposed to stop with us. The lack is supposed to stop with us. The loneliness and the unhappiness and not being fulfilled and not being creative and not expressing yourself and not being who you are. It's supposed to stop with you. It's not supposed to go another generation, another level. Sanity must come with us.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
And I feel like even with the younger generation, I feel like, you know, they rebel so much because they know they're being sold a bill of goods. And then we wonder why they don't want to do what we're doing. They see how freaking crazy it is and how it's not making us happy. So why should I want to do what you're doing and you're the most miserable person I know? And you're trying to tell me the benefits of your beliefs. Yeah. Then you say, I have a rebellious child. Yes, you do. They don't want to do the insanity. And the thing about it is, whatever the truth is, we know we're going to find out what the truth is. Sooner or later, you're going to have to face whatever it is. So you don't have to worry about that. You will come to recognize the truth, you know. And so let's hear about the happy parents who come together. Say, if you were lucky, both parents consciously decided to use their body as a communication device for teaching only love. So your parent, both your dad is saying, you know what, dear? I think I desire to use my body as a communication device for teaching only love, and I'm going to give that love to you, and we're going to give that love to each other. You got a communication device called a body, and you want to use it for love, and I got a communication device called a body, and I'm going to use my body to love you, and you're going to use your body to love me, and I'm going to use my body to love you, and you're going to use your body to love me, and we're going to use our bodies to express love to everybody. That's what two conscious beings say. Then they accepted that the little spark of light that begins yet the birthing of another body, that is, so a conscious being produces a body as an invitation to another soul to come and live with them.
Wow.
So two parents that want to have a baby are saying, we are inviting a soul to come in and live with us because we want to teach love through our body. That is beautiful. It kind of chokes me up, man. Don't y'all get kind of choked up?
Yeah.
That's kind of cool to think that your parents got down to invite you in. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is different from what we hear every day.
Yeah.
Have you noticed, why do you think it's so hard to hear something this different? Even though it's interesting. Why do you think you have to sometimes fight to stay conscious? Anybody?
It seems unreal.
Because it seems so unreal, it's hard to stay conscious and listen to it. That's why you have to check in with your feelings and get out of your, what, head.
Mm-hmm.
If you're listening to this from your head, you're going to go unconscious. But if you listen to it from the perspective of what resonates to the deepest truth in your soul, you'll find that what I'm saying is not something that's that way off. That, as a matter of fact, it makes more sense than the stuff we were taught.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
This makes a hell of a lot more sense than anything I was taught.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that two souls come together because they want to teach love and express love through their bodies, so they create a body, they invite a soul to come into that body so they can love it together as parents. But that's true about anything physical that you create. You know, you can create a car, you can create a house, you can create relationships. You're supposed to use them for the same reason, the reason of, I'm going to use this as an opportunity for me to see if I can give and receive some love. That's the kind of people I want to be in a relationship with.
Mm-hmm.
Because, see, when you came in through the body that your parents invited you in through by having sex with each other, even if they didn't like each other, because that was just their egos. Got that? Their egos didn't like each other, but some part of them liked each other enough to create the little wiggly thing that produced the kid. Okay? And so that was an invitation to a soul to come in. But what was the soul supposed to be? What was the child supposed to be? It was supposed to be a teacher and a friend and a brother or a sister. So your child is also your teacher. Your child is also your friend. Your child is your brother, or your child is your sister. And unfortunately, that is yet rare upon your planet.
Yeah.
It's very rare for people to come together in this conscious way. So what do y'all think about that idea of birth?
Wish I could do it over.
You wish you could do what?
Do it over.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
With a new perception, with a new attitude about it?
New perception, new attitude, same three kids,
though. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, that's what's cool, though, is that right now you could take that attitude, right?
Yep.
So right now you could say, oh, now I know what my daughter is. Right now I know what my son is. You know,
mm-hmm.
she came into this experience so that she could learn how to use her body for love. I can learn how to use my body for love. And even that which created her on the father's side could use his body for love, whether we ever see him or he's ever around or anything like that. So if I was to say my body is here for the purpose of love, would that help my body be healthy?
Mm. Oh, yeah.
That would have a big effect on my body. Could we make that decision tonight?
Yes.
That the purpose of my body is to love. Now what? Now let's make that more practical. The purpose of my body is to free my mind. Because love is freedom. So when you say love, you're saying I'm going to use my body for freedom. I'm going to use my body to free me. I'm going to use my body to free my mind.
Mm.
That's what you're doing tonight. You use your body to get in the car, however you got over here, to sit in the chair, to listen to this book, to free your mind. So you're using your body to free you by using your body to come around someone that's teaching you that you deserve to be loved and you deserve to be happy.
Mm-hmm.
The ego does not want to hear anything that I'm saying. Your ego does not want to hear anything that I'm saying. Your ego doesn't want to hear anything that I'm saying. Your ego doesn't want to hear any of this. Your ego doesn't want to hear any of this. Your ego wants to put you to sleep. Your ego wants you to put you to sleep. Your ego wants to put you to sleep. Your ego doesn't want you to hear anything that I'm saying. Your ego doesn't want you to believe anything that you're hearing. Your ego doesn't want to. Remember, the fear wants to keep itself going. So how do you get past that? You have to be proactive. You have to go, I am going to decide to really focus my attention on the truth and not give in to my ego all the time. What would that look like? Look like when you get ready to attack somebody, you close your mouth and breathe and don't do it.
Mm.
That's one way it looks. It looks like you know you're in a class that's about us waking up to who we really are. So you try to be as present and take part as much as you possibly can so that you can stay awake and hear it. You become proactive about your awakening. I'm proactive. I'm not waiting for this to show up. I made sure it showed up. That's why I'm sitting here. I'm proactive. You know, so what happened as a result of that? More and more of everything I've ever wanted in my heart. Less and less and less and less drama and negative people. More and more and more love. More and more opportunities for love. More and more joy. More and more peace. It didn't look anything like I thought it would look. I didn't think it would look like a small church in Denver, Colorado in the living room with 13 people. That's not what I envisioned 20 years ago when I set out to teach. But I find I'm completely peaceful. So maybe your happiness doesn't look like what you think it's going to look like. Mm. And maybe it's your picture of happiness that's keeping you from being happy sooner. Because you already decided what's going to make you happy. And maybe what will end up making you happy won't look anything like what you think. Probably that's the condition for it being something that's making you happy. This has got to be something that you are not thinking. Because looking at what you're thinking has got you. And some of you might say, I'm glad of what my thinking has got me. Some of you might say, wow, I look at what my thinking has got me. Some of you might have a mixture of both of it. So what is the thing you love to do? I don't care how meaningless it is, because it's usually got to be meaningless for us to do it. Okay, we don't get excited unless it's totally meaningless. And the more meaningless it is, the more well paid you are for it. Nothing about my life depends on the Broncos winning the Super Bowl.
Right.
But we'll be glad to pay any Bronco $50 million a year. We will be PO'd if a doctor made $50 million a year. We would say he was a scam. Now, he's doing something to heal people. We resent him receiving money. Something as meaningless as football, and I'm not putting football down, but I'm just being honest about it. It's meaningless. It's enjoyable, but it's nobody's life depends on the football game, really, except somebody who made a bet they can't pay back. Big moments after. So my point is, we do games just for the fun of it.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That the game doesn't necessarily have to have a purpose. We're doing it just for the fun of it. And this is a game. This is the separation game. This is the human game. This is the game of what would it be like if we were separate in bodies, able to express ourselves uniquely in different ways, in a physical form, with physical senses. What would that be like? How could we experience that? And we're also going to play the game that we've forgotten that we're the holy children of God and that we have unlimited power to create. And we're going to pretend that we're human beings who are on our own, separate, trying to make it against forces beyond our control in a hostile world that sometimes we can get a few kind relationships with that we can count on until we die.
Right.
That's the game we're playing. Some people are playing the game of I'm lonely. There's nobody out there for me. There's some people are playing the game of there's not enough money. There's some people are playing the game of I never have a career that works. And there are some people playing the game that I'm fulfilled in my job, have the best relationships I could ever have, and that my life is working on every level, and I wonder what it would be like to play that game. So what game are you playing? And don't judge yourself by your game. It's just a game. It's just a game. You're just a game. It's just a friggin' game. You're playing the human game. But how do you keep yourself from enjoying the human game? How can you keep yourself from it? Well, let's make up the idea of guilt and sin. That'll pretty much blow the game.
Yeah.
Because now when you do certain things, you're a bad person that's going to hell. So then you in the physical body because you wanted to experience the physical body and have the sensations of the spiritual physical body because you're an unlimited being. So you thought it'd be cool to see what it'd be like to be a human being. But then you made up the idea of all these stupid rules that don't have anything to do with anything that you judge yourself by and make yourself feel guilty about so that you never enjoy your physical body. Isn't that messed up?
Yeah.
It really is. It's like nobody's stopping you from doing what you want to do but you, based on arcane rules that you learned as a child that you are claiming that you don't believe, but then you acting just like it's true.
Mm-hmm.
Have a nice day. So, then check this out. Can we get deeper? I mean, y'all with me now? Now, I'll stop if y'all want me to stop at 8 o'clock. If you're bored, I'm okay. My feelings won't be hurt. I'd rather stop where everybody's juicy than everybody kill over. Do y'all want to keep going?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. I'm cool. I've gone to do workshops and got there and felt like I had everything I had to say it in 2 hours and told the people. I pretty much feel like I said everything. I know it's supposed to last to 5, but I really pretty much said everything I got to say. You can have your money back if it's not okay, because I'm through. I feel complete. And they would go, we pretty much complete too. You can keep the money. Because I was honest, because I wasn't in it for the money. Same thing is true in this moment. I'm okay if it's an hour class. I'd rather end at an hour than everybody be straining. Really, because I'm okay. But this kind of stuff, I never get enough of it. Mm-hmm. See, when everybody's about to fall over and die, I'm just getting warmed up. I'd much rather something like this than 99% of the conversations that people have with me that they're completely excited about. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Really. It's like, they'd be like, I'd be in restaurants, like, what are they saying? Because everybody, and you're like, listening over to somebody's conversation, you'd be going, what? You can't even believe it, but you love their enthusiasm for what they're talking about. And I enjoy the energy of enthusiasm. Mm-hmm. So I don't really care what they're talking about if they're excited about it. Because mm-hmm. enthusiasm creates. That's how you create, is through enthusiasm. All right, I'm going to go into something deeper then. Okay. You ready?
Right. Yeah, I'm ready.
All right, that's it. That's right. I like to make it so intense you have to pee. I'm going to get it myself. That was my worst nightmare when I used a wireless mic. Was to go to the bathroom with the mic on and didn't know it. But it has happened to speakers before.
That's funny.
All of a sudden, the audience sitting out there and they hear. That's happened before. That's embarrassing. Mm-hmm. It didn't happen to me, but it's happened before. So that's what made me kind of, I love this dream. It's so good. He says, that is the matrix into which you have descended time and time again. You have come to teach yourself that you are just a separate, lonely, failing, weak individual. So when people are afraid and they're in the body, they're just teaching themselves that they're separate, lonely, failing, weak individuals. At the death of the body, you have found yourself as soul, and have been frightened by the radiance of your light, because that light is not the same as your interpretation that you have learned of yourself. So when you die, then you become frightened at the fact that you see that you were never a body, that you were radiant friggin' light. Mm-hmm. And then he says you become afraid because what you thought you were, your interpretation of what you were, is not true. That everything you learned about what you were wasn't true. That you are light and you are more than a body. That's what you really are. That's a literal truth. You are light. Woo! So you're going to be shocked when you die. Nobody's gazing at the body in the casket with more wonder than the person that's supposed to be dead. You're like, whoa! I'm scared of killing. Then you look to see who showed up. I knew they wasn't gonna call. One of the most appalling things about people dying, and I don't care how close they are to you, you and everything moves on. Mm-hmm. Have you ever noticed that? Mm-hmm. I don't care how close, as close as the person was, you still move on. Mm-hmm. And you still laugh, and you still go to movies, and you still go to the park. But I'm so special that I think that when I go, everybody's supposed to be sad forever. They're not ever supposed to ever be normal again. You know what I'm saying? Because it was me. I died. But then you see it happen all the time. People die. Your mama, your dad. I remember telling myself I couldn't survive my mother's transition when I was young, because I was so close to my mother. I was just sure. Sometimes to my mother, I was done. I couldn't live past that. You know, that happened 23 years ago. I'm still here, and I still go to movies, and I still. You see what I'm saying? So understand. Why you are not letting yourself enjoy yourself because you're so concerned about what other people think. It's a trick. Mm-hmm. Nobody's thinking about you as much mm-hmm. as you are.
Yeah.
So you better enjoy yourself and don't be like, oh my God, you know, it's like it's up to me to do everything by myself on my own. It's all on my shoulders. It's like, no, it's not. Everybody's responsible for their experience. And everybody's got the Holy Spirit and God with them. Nobody's alone and nothing that they're going through, and they have help that they can call on anytime they want to. And so do you. Mm-hmm. It's just waiting to get, just waiting to help you. Yeah, waiting for you to acknowledge it exists. Fear causes condensation. Interesting statement. Fear causes condensation, contraction. In other words, fear causes falling, if you will. And when you and what you fall into is a matrix of energy that best resonates with your own perception and belief about yourself. Okay. So when you feel afraid, you fall into an energy that best resonates with your own perception of yourself. So what you are experiencing is a matrix of energy that best represents and resonates with your own ideas about yourself. You are surrounded by an environment that most fits your perception of yourself. That's where you live right now. Your friends, your physical situation, every situation that you're in right now is nothing but a matrix of energy that's formed around your own beliefs about yourself. So you're living within the body of your own beliefs right now. All the while, you are yet that God one. You, even while you're in whatever situation that you're in right now, you are still radiant. You are still perfectly free. You are using the very power of God to create and believe in a dream of smallness, weakness, separation, and loneliness. I'm an unlimited spiritual being using all my power to create smallness, weakness, separation, loneliness. I'm using all my power to create loneliness, if that's the way I feel. Now, how can you know when you're always making a mistake? And how can you know when you're doing it right? Whenever you tell yourself if something outside of yourself were different, you'd be happy, is when you've forgotten where your power is located. Whenever you act like it's society, culture, your gender, your sex, your race, the country, the minute you attribute anything you're going through to something outside of yourself, you're in total forgetfulness and you're trapped. Mm. Don't ever say the reason I don't have something is because of some external condition. I don't have nobody because I'm too old, too young, too poor, too rich. Anytime you use any kind of external reason why I'm not educated enough, whatever you tell yourself that has anything to do with people don't like me, it's the way that I look, it's the times I live in. You tell yourself anything like that, you are totally denying your power and limiting yourself and blocking your good. Thank you. Thank you out there in the wilderness. Thank you. Where are you? Where are you? Opportunity for comment, question.
This whole belief system in yourself, I think there's a big transformation in that as far as my past relationship, and I didn't realize it because it was a subconscious belief system that I'm a worthless piece of shit, and it was reflected in the wife that I married.
That's right.
Yeah, she let me know that all the time. So
let's thank her.
Yeah.
We want to acknowledge, we want to, whatever her name is, we want to acknowledge you for playing the role that he assigned to you with Oscar-worthy performance.
But then there's the transformation of the belief system that I'm not that.
Yeah.
Right.
That I'm
right.
much greater than that.
But then what kind of woman did you attract?
Absolutely. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
A different kind?
You know her.
Yes, I do.
Yeah.
Awesome. Awesome, awesome, and did I say awesome? Absolutely.
So yeah, there's that letting go, that whole the kind of making that transformation into the new belief system, and then relying on God, higher power, source, whatever, tapping into that. That's where I, that's where I resonate from.
That's right.
And then as a result of that, the manifestations in my life now. And then, the friends that I used to have all fallen by the wayside, and a whole new group of friends have surrounded me with love and support.
Mm-hmm.
And
cool.
It's just an amazing transformation.
And the only thing that happened was you changed your own idea about yourself.
Absolutely.
And that's what's so cool, because that's what I can be in control of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm trying to get you all to change for me to be happy. Mm-hmm. That's a pretty depressing thought. Right? Because it's not going to happen.
Right.
But I can just do all kinds of things with Earl. And that's what I'm going to do this year. Mm-hmm. I'm going to do all kinds of things with him. Mm-hmm. But I got to make him be absolutely sure he's innocent. Mm-hmm. First. Mm-hmm. He's got to be rooted in his innocence. Mm-hmm. Because I'm going to take my limitations, my upper limits off me, get out of the box and see what shows up. If I look at it like I'm an infant that's in the crib, that's just been born, that has a loving parent that will clean me and take care of me and teach me how to communicate in this new reality as an unlimited loving being of God, which means I can no longer give any credence to what the world of fear teaches, and I can't live by the values that I was taught by fearful minds. Mm-hmm. And I can't compromise on that anymore, regardless of what anybody else around me does. Mm-hmm. That's the decision that I made. Heaven, which is happiness, is a decision. It's not some outer circumstance. Mm-hmm. If you tell me you're happy because of anything that happened to you on the outer, then I know that's not real happiness, even though that feels good, and I'm glad that you're having that feeling. But don't fool yourself into thinking that that's real happiness, because real happiness can't be shaken by anything. That's how you know when you're there. Nothing can make you unhappy. Somebody leave, you go, oh, wow, that was a great experience I had with them. I just can't wait to see what Spirit is going to send to me next. Oh, that's going to be exciting. Oh, I got laid off today. I got laid off today. I got laid off today. I got a bankruptcy. I got a bankruptcy. My credit score is 50. Yeah. I know that's a God because I got a good credit score. I don't know how that happened. Maybe I had a positive identity theft. That's what happened. Somebody hacked into my credit account and better credit than me. That's the way it is when you start to believe in that. I'm telling you, stuff started to happen that just doesn't make any sense. But somehow or another, it all worked out. You're being taken care of, the thing is straight, and you go, what? How did that happen? Because you are committed to remembering that you are unlimited creativity in physical form, and that you're innocent, and that you're not alone, and that you got guidance, and you want to learn what the real rules are, and not the rules that fearful minds taught you. Mm-hmm. That creates the so-called magic. Yes, ma'am.
Not as intense as the credit score, but little stuff happens to me like that all the time. Like, I went to go get my new ID,
mm-hmm.
and my eyesight's bad, but it's not bad enough to where I really realize my contacts are out sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
Forgot to wear my contacts, like, failed my vision's test, and she's like, you know what, I'm sorry, I don't know what to do. Oh, come on, I'm getting new contacts on Monday, like, it's Friday, I'm sorry. She's like, looked around, like, let me use her glasses. Like, totally, and I think I failed it again, but she was shaking her head. And she gave it to me anyway.
Yes, that's what I'm talking about. Right. It's all right to borrow somebody else's vision when you can't see. You know, what a great metaphysical lesson in that.
So nice. Would you ever meet someone like that at the DMV? Yeah.
That was cute.
It's like darn miraculous victorious, the DMV. That's what it is. I, same thing with me. I could just I remember one time I got this message. I was supposed to go to Houston, Texas. I mean, yeah, Houston. I don't forget that. I just got in the course a couple of years. All of a sudden, I met somebody named Houston. Whitney Houston had the number one song. It was Houston everywhere, you know. And then I said, well, Holy Spirit, I don't have the money to go to Houston. And I opened up my Course in Miracles book, and it was $300 bills in my Course in Miracles book. So, you know, so he wanted me to take the bus to Houston. So, and so I went, whoa. And then a friend of mine called me and said, I was in meditation, and I just got this message that said, I need to give you some money so you could go to Houston. And so I went, I told my wife, I was married at that time. I told her, I said, I'm getting ready to go to Houston. She said, okay. She was used to me. And I went down to the bus station to get on the bus, and they said the bus was full and that they didn't have room enough for me on the bus. And so I said, wow, but I'm supposed to be in Houston. I just, for some reason, and they said, well, then a few minutes later, they said, we had a brand new bus. We got an extra bus that we're going to use for that route, because whatever reason. I got on the bus. I was the only one on the whole bus. So I was on the Greyhound bus all by myself with the bus driver who was singing. You know, and I'm like, well, whoa! You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And then I was going there to meet a lady named Chaka, who I'd never met before. She just told me where to have the cab drop me off at. I walk into the building. Soon as I walk into the building, this woman comes out of the restroom with a name tag on that said Chaka. I mean, as soon as I walked in, Chaka walked out of the restroom with a label on her chest. And I can just tell you one thing after another thing after another thing that happened on that trip that changed my whole life, that I had some experiences on that trip that absolutely flat changed my whole life. But you have to get to the point that you trust when you don't always know every step of the way that you're going to go. We always act like you got to know everything. It's got to be guaranteed down to the most minute detail before we'll possibly do anything. Mm-hmm. But really, the most powerful and helpful and magical experiences I've ever had has been when I've been willing to get out the box, risk, and trust.
Yeah.
But in spirit, that's how I ended up here.
Yeah.
You know, so we are unlimited. The invisible is rooting for us to stop being so afraid, to be willing to follow our bliss, follow our heart, not what makes us feel secure. Mm-hmm. That's the lowest level of consciousness you can live on.
Mm-hmm.
It's the security level. When your whole life is about security, the true security is being connected to source.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's true. So I'm doing all the time. I'm studying to get rid of everything in my mind that keeps me from being able to align myself with God. That's my answer to everything. I don't care what it is. So, oh, okay, I got a problem. I got a toothache. Oh, that means I think I'm separate from God. Oh, my God, my car got a flat. Oh, it thinks I'm separate from God. I use everything to remind me of God. Because if you do that, the part of you that wants you to forget God will stop giving you a hard time, troubles, and problems to make you forget God. Because every time you have a problem, you go into the truth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If that part of your mind is trying to block you, knows that every time it messes with you, you're going to go to the truth. It'll stop messing with you.
Mm-hmm.
But if I can give you a couple of problems and you don't come to class, you don't read, you don't study, you don't meditate, and you forget all this stuff, then I'm going to give you more and more challenges and conflicts to forget by. You know, the best time to use the truth is when you're most upset. That's the most important time to use it is when you're upset, not when you think everything is going great. That's good too. But you really need to use it when you're upset, because that's the purpose of the upset, is to make you forget the truth.
Yeah.
And it works almost every time with people.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care how much they said they're into this stuff. Had one little thing come up and then they drop it. And then what does that tell that ego mind? Oh, if I just give him hell, he never will try to wake up and go for love. So then you just get more stuff dumped on you, and more stuff dumped on you, and more stuff dumped. But the minute your mind gets, oh boy, your ego mind goes, if I mess with Earl, he's going to go straight to the friggin' way of mastering the Course in Miracles. He's going to call up somebody and they're going to read together. He's going to remind himself of the truth. I'm going to leave him alone. Your fear will go, I can't, because if I mess with him, he's going to do the thing that's going to help get rid of the fear. So I gotta leave him alone. But if I can mess with you and anything that upsets you, you forget the truth, I'm going to give you more stuff to get upset about mm-hmm. so you can keep on forgetting it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Hmm. So what's the answer? The answer is go straight to the truth. I don't care what is going on. I don't care how you feel. Mm. Because if you convince your mind that that's where you're going every time, it'll stop creating challenges for you. But you will have growth opportunities because we're here to evolve. And that's fun. To go, what's next? What could I be next? How could I express myself next? What's the next thing that's going to happen to me? What's the gifts of my age? What are my psychic powers at my age? How can I express more love at my age? What can I create at my age? My age is a gift. Mm-hmm. And your age is a gift. No matter what that age is, there's something about that age that has a special gift for you. Uh-huh. Sometimes at certain ages, you just have the gift of just being fine. You know, which can be a dangerous gift if you don't know how to use it. Uh-huh. That is, it can be a danger because you don't have to have no sense.
Yeah.
It's the truth. If you look good, you are good, so everybody wants you, even if you're crazy as hell.
Especially.
Yeah, especially if you're crazy as hell. That's like the condition. You know, you got to be crazy. Be fine and crazy. That's what I want. Now that's the last thing I want. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Crazy. That's the key word. Crazy.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You know, I want somebody that wants to take responsibility to remember who they really are. And then go for the joy and go for the peace. Would you acknowledge yourself for hearing this much? Thank you again for tuning in to As the Black Man Ranks. It's a very, very important class. I appreciate that. We're gonna do the financial expression of appreciation right now. Thank you for sharing. Thank you for sharing so much for sharing with me, with my full-time ministry, with the Way of Mastering the Course in Miracles. Those of you watching online, thank you so much. And if you want to make a financial expression of appreciation because you appreciate what's going on through me, would you please go to www.earlpurdy.com, earlpurdy.com. And I do one-on-one sessions called Clarity Sessions through Skype, phone, and I use Web Mastery, Course in Miracles, and my knowledge of astrology and numerology. If you want to find out more about that, go to my website, www.earlpurdy.com. And we get a chance to talk to you and bring all this truth to whatever it is you think you're going through right now. Go to my website to sign up for my contact list, and then I'll send you a link in the mail so that you can directly watch all of these classes that are videoing. So do that also. I'm here only to be truly helpful. That's it. That's the only reason. So thank you for all of the wonderful support that I've been receiving from everybody here and everybody online. It's a trip that my analytics say I'm being watched in 87 countries.
Hey.
And my number fourth largest audience is South Korea.
Wow.
Isn't that South Korea?
That's a trip.
Yeah, it's like South Korea. You know, I don't know what that's about.
Yeah.
All right. So. What I want to do is take about 5 minutes before we go out into the dream to have you just cool out for a minute, and I'm going to just do a quick review. And I just don't even want you to do it. Just close your eyes and just relax, all right, before we go out into the dream. And I got something I want to say to you. Know that everything that I've said to you tonight is what you are doing. You are choosing how you will think of yourself. You're the one that's choosing how you think about yourself. You are the one that's choosing the way you think about yourself. You are the one that's choosing the way you think about yourself. And how you think about yourself is reflected in the world that you see. How you think about yourself is reflected in the world that you see. How you think about yourself is reflected in the world that you see. How you think about yourself is reflected in the world that you see. How you think about yourself is reflected in the experiences that are manifest within your own particular universe of consciousness. If you knew that you were the unlimited one, if you knew that you were the unlimited one, you would never fear the creation of money again. If you knew that you were the unlimited one, you would never fear the creation of money or relationship or career again. You would never believe that you must live in lack. But you are still, for the most part, clinging to the belief that you are that small little thought of separation called the egoic mind. For the most part, you are still clinging to the belief that you are still struggling to find God, not recognizing that it is the very power of God's presence from which you create the perception you hold of yourself. You are using the power of God right now to create the perception you hold of yourself. You don't recognize that it's the very power of your Creator's presence from which you are creating the way that you experience your life right now. So there you are, sitting upon your chair. You are in form. That is, you have created a perception of yourself. You have created a perception of yourself that includes the experience of being a body, mind, which is separate from all other bodies. You have created, sitting right there in that chair, you have created a perception of yourself that includes the experience of having a body and having a mind that seems to be in a body, separate from all other bodies. But that is what this world is. This universe is the attempt to create a reflection that convinces you that the first fearful thought of separation is the truth of who you are. This universe is the attempt to create a reflection that convinces you of your thoughts about yourself. This universe is the attempt to create a reflection that convinces you of all the thoughts you have about yourself. This universe is an attempt on your part to create for yourself the reflection of everything that you believe about yourself. The magical power of this universe is that it will attempt to create a reflection that convinces you of anything you believe about yourself and others. So we ask that the universe reflect the love We ask that the universe reflect the abundance. We ask that the universe reflect God to us. We ask that the universe reflect joy to us. We ask that the universe reflect true security and safety to us. We ask the universe to reflect pure bliss and ecstasy to us. We ask the universe to reflect back to us the passion and desire of our greatest joy and heart's desire, and a reflection of our beauty and our power and our innocence. We are as God love created us. So be it. So there. I appreciate y'all. Thanks for coming out tonight. Remember, you have such wonderful matrices of energy with vibration that's out of the friggin' world. So thank you so much. Hugs are available, 1 o'clock on Sunday. The Course in Miracles. I love you, baby.